8 minutes of pre-show. Hello, world.
Hello, radio.
So now our secret guest has been revealed. In the tiny monitor down here, you can see who the secret guest is. So we have a few minutes to talk about fun stuff before we talk about stuff that's no fun. Well, I don't know. Maybe you think ARRL politics is fun. She's not saying.
Do I think ARRL politics is fun? You know?
We're here to play.
I don't know.
We want to play radio. We want to do technology. We want to meet people. But
I'll tell you this. It was fun when we were winning. But
yeah. I think we'll need to go through a little history to see how we got here before we talk about where we are and where things might go.
Uh-huh. You guys have packages coming towards you tomorrow. These were supposed to arrive in time for Quartzfest, but they didn't.
It's a little foam block with our logo on it.
No, they're stickers. These are stickers. In fact, it actually worked out perfectly such that, Jim, you don't have to worry about buying a mic flag. You just have to 3D print one because it's exactly the same size as the stickers I ordered. So I'll send you some stickers.
Yeah, that flag's going to work really well on the PR30.
Yeah, it'll be a problem, but you'll figure it out. I was hoping they'd come before I left, but alas.
Yeah, let's see. We as live as we think we are?
Yeah, we are.
Yeah, we are, and there's people in the chat room and 7 people watching. I posted the entirety of the ARRL forum.
Oh yeah, I saw. Yeah, good.
About an hour ago. So that was my commitment to Dick, was I was going to share it all and we're going to rip apart the parts you want to talk about, but I told him I would put it up there as I asked.
I must tell you, having, you know, the insider knowledge that I have now, watching Dick at Quartzfest gives a whole new context to things.
Did you get a chance to play that?
Oh yeah.
And Jim was in the dirt lot where it happened, so
shaking my head going, what is he talking about?
Okay. Jim and his Airstream.
So if anybody wants to go hear Dick's entire talk, the hot stuff is in the last 15 or 20 minutes or so, I think.
Well, I think, you know, it's all valuable. There are some challenging things in there, and that is at the end, but it's all, you know, I guess if you lived in the Southwest Division, it's all appropriate. It's all important stuff. And yes, some controversy.
You know, Dick and I did work on something, and there's a little bit of backstory I could probably tell you, but, you know, don't want to, I want to save it because it's
the show before the show.
Yeah. I want the people to hear it during the show.
Yeah. I'm with you.
You know, I still owe you and, Marty Wall. I need to meet you guys when I'm in California.
We don't owe us anything, but it'd be great to catch up.
Well, you know, I feel bad that I go there. You know, when I go there, it's a very compressed schedule. I go there, they might take me to an event at a winery or dealing with some dealers, or I sound like I'm selling drugs. But I get it.
I used to travel for a living, and people would say, yeah, well, you ever come to town? I'm like, I'm there all the time, but you know, you get off a plane and you go see somebody and you go see somebody else and you sleep in a hotel and you get up and you go see somebody and then you're right back to where you started from. But we'll connect at some point.
Yeah, we will. No, I'll make some time next time I'm there. I'll plan it better. But it is exactly like that. You get on a plane, you get off, and oddly enough, people tell me fly into Burbank, I fly into LAX, and then, you know, it's like I get my rental car, I drive around, I buy things that I forgot to pack in my suitcase.
Yeah. Burbank's not a great, you're coming from the East Coast, there's not
right.
There's not a lot of great service, although my daughter and I flew couple times to JFK, and it wasn't actually ended up being very convenient. And I work across the street from the airport there in Burbank. So it's cool to have the free parking with a short walk.
I'm getting warning danger signs from
warning
from danger. The stream.
From what? Are you not solid today?
Yeah, it's going between green, yellow, and red.
Check. Did you check the output?
Did I check the quality output?
Change? I had some Windows update that changed a whole bunch of my sleep settings and.
Oh yeah, let me make sure that the output.
Make sure it's still streaming. It's still stereo and it's still at. It's not at 8K. Where's my power?
Oh. Facebook's at 4 megabits. Is it supposed to be? YouTube is at 4 megabits. Is it supposed to be? Let's see if I can isolate who the... Whether it's YouTube or...
Well, just don't go live on Facebook. You know, we had problems last time. It timed out. And nobody watches or cares there, and we just upload it after the fact.
All green and happy right now.
Kent says no buffering. I don't see any buffering either.
Did you work any Winterfield area?
No, I did not. I've been busy with a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
I did not. It's like, I wanted to. I normally go to WECA's Winter Field Day site, Westchester Emergency Communications Association. This year I just didn't, I had a deadline.
YouTube says it's an excellent connection right now, so I guess we'll just go with it.
Sometimes it does, you know, it's kind of like a buggy thing. Sometimes it does that when you don't have a lot of sound and you get a low bit rate, and I think the warning is triggered by bit rate.
Yep, stream is healthy, or so it says. So you were going to do a live show tonight, Rhea, and you decided not to, I guess?
Yeah, like I said, I have my deadline. I was like furiously on a computer before this.
Yeah, and I noticed that Josh Jason, Amradio 2.0, who normally starts his live stream at 8 p.m., got started at about 9:15 because he was on the road, I guess, coming back from courtside, I guess. I don't know. Or from somewhere. Anyway, he was really late, so he's still going, so we won't have any audience.
Maybe people want to, I don't know, see me talk about the ARRL.
We should all go into his chat room for a minute and tell him that would be bad form, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I think let's not say we did.
Okay.
So let's not say we didn't.
Let me push the music. This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. I think I made the title go away prematurely. Episode 462, The Angry Radio Relay League. How's that title sound, Rhea?
It's so angry, it's blocking me out.
It is, yeah. I really need to adjust how this works. It's going to go away in just a minute. Don't worry about that. From the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, at the foot of Mount Belzoni in the shadow of Charlotte. I really don't know how to run this thing anymore. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. David, please talk.
And from the freezing cold garage below my parents' house, from Mulholland Drive at the base of the Santa Monica Mountains in Topanga Canyon, I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Jim, please talk.
And from the heart of Silicon Valley, the base of Mount Amunam,
Eminem.
Aspinwall, NO1PC.
Mount Eminem.
Amunam.
Amunam.
Mount Hummingbird.
Get that somewhere. Rhea, talk to me.
And from the Hudson Division in northern New Jersey, it's somewhere in the base of what we pretend to call mountains. I'm Rhea, and to RJ.
And as a moment ago said, Angry Radio Relay League, January 29th, 2023. And I guess the point is, things are in turmoil again in Boardland.
Indeed.
Up at the ARRL. And you have, if I'm remembering correctly, there's three things going on in order of escalation. I'm not sure what the order is. One of them was a comment that you made a while ago on the cover of the January QST, Volunteers Lead the Way. And you noted something about this group.
Well, that wasn't me. That was a friend. And
you chimed in?
And I happen to agree, but you know, I think there is context to that. And I think I don't blame, you know, the league for photographing this kind of cover. I just think it's symptomatic. I think it's not the disease, it's a symptom.
Yeah. We're looking at 98% white guys, one white woman, no diversity whatsoever. That's not what was in their mind when they shot that picture. And weren't thinking about that at all. They were thinking, here's our volunteers. This will be fun.
And I will say that I commend anyone who volunteers for the league. And, you know, I really don't care about their race or ethnicity or, you know, gender or orientation / identity or whatever. I just care that they want to serve the league. I do think that, you know, that the whole thing about it is not intended to criticize the league for that and criticize volunteers. I really, like I said, I appointed a section manager for Northern New Jersey, and he is a very old retired gentleman, but he's very dedicated, and I really applaud him for that, you know? But at the same time, I'm kind of discouraged that, you know, we don't have like a different set of people who want to volunteer for the league. And I think there are a few things that kind of, you know, discourage them from doing that.
Yeah. Well,
is that the league or is what's discouraging?
So I think, and this is a, okay, here we go into the politics.
Trick question. Didn't mean
to diving right in.
Jim, I love you, Jim. Okay. Funny. No, let me tell you. So the thing is, I do think that unintentionally, most likely, somehow, you know, the coverage in QST tends to skew a little one way. Like I made a comment to the CEO, to Mr. Minster, saying that for Dayton, we had so many people who are, you know, of all different colors, people who look like me and people who look like others. I'm not saying photograph me. I will gladly smile for a photo, but I'm not, my goal is not to get in the magazine. I made a comment to him. I said, you know, there is so much people, and then frankly, people from all the world, yet the photos in QST did not reflect that. And I said, I really don't think it's intentional. I would hate to believe it was intentional, you know, but it just, it really bothers me. And I got lashed out against for that.
Yeah, I think
so hard.
That's the thing that irritated me when I heard about the incident is not that you commented on it, but that the reaction was so negative and severe.
To be clear, it wasn't that cover. This was a lot earlier. This was the, I think it might have been June or July QST, the one that reported on Dayton.
Okay. Yeah, it took me a while to dig that up, but I've been in the advertising business for a long time. You've been in the media business for a long time. And we know that when we go to cast a commercial, a TV show, whatever it is we're putting together, we deliberately look for diversity, because if you don't deliberately look for diversity, you will find none.
Right. And another director brought up the idea of, I don't know if he called it unconscious or subconscious bias. And he had us do a test from Harvard, basically. Well, he asked us to do a test from Harvard, right? There's like an online test, and I'm sure some people did it, but, it raised a point that, well, you know what? People have biases. And the thing is, how do you overcome those? I don't have the answer for that, but I think that definitely there needs to be some effort to overcome that.
Okay. I was trying to dig out the QST from after.
Well, is that a factor in people volunteering for the league? Is there, that's what I was getting at. I mean, have we found something that says they don't feel it's valuable time? They don't feel they'd be appreciated. Do they feel they're not walking into a warm, wholesome environment? Or,
Jim, I would say yes, and people beat up on me for that, but I'll tell you that the answer is yes. And it has nothing to do with the volunteers. It has to do, I've spoken to hams, who are basically, for lack of a better word, diverse, okay? Mm-hmm. And I've asked, and basically the comment was, some of them said, well, you go 20 years of QST and not one black person was on the cover, or maybe one person of color in 20 years, right? And I kind of looked at it and I'm like, holy smokes, and I can't believe it.
So it's sort of the same kind of cranky old guy thing that affects new hams coming into almost any forum of social media, and they get, just Google it, just look it up. You ought to know this, you passed your test. It sounds like it, perhaps an extension of being a curmudgeon.
No, I just think that, I think is really unintentional. I think by and large, the league, looks for things that, I guess they look for user submissions and they look for people who do fantastic things in amateur radio. It's just that, it kind of like, I almost want to say it snowballs, right? And then you have like people who are doing these things ended up being, of one demographic. And then other people kind of like get discouraged and they say, well, there's nobody like me in there. So, I suspect that, and I see this as well, even in my work stuff, right? We have like, I don't want to get too specific because I don't want to reveal exactly what we do, but we have a lot of efforts where we seek out people of, different people. Like we have, hiring events for women, for example. We have hiring events and we have, we seek out people who are diverse. We have networks of, black professionals. We have networks of different kind of like Asian professionals. We have, of all sorts of different people, and we network together and we have basically, a kind of like a strategy on how to enhance your career. And then the company will then take that and then, bring that into seeing how it can improve its diversity. This doesn't mean that they go and basically try to, hire people who are just based on race, right? What they do is they try to kind of like, look for, try to broaden the search a little bit. And, a lot of companies who have diverse hiring practices and a welcoming environment, they do very well. So, something's got to work. I think a lot of people, when they feel welcome, they feel happy. We have like a lot of cultural events. We had a Juneteenth celebration, and I didn't even know Juneteenth was a thing. Apparently it is a thing in Texas, but.
Yeah, very important thing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Becoming more of a thing every place. June 19th, it's You know, so, a moment ago, I could have told you what the derivation was. It was learning about the end of the Civil War and the Emancipation Proclamation in Texas.
Somebody finally getting to Texas to let the slaves know that they were freed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So
sometime after it actually happened otherwise.
Yeah. Rhea, do you think ham radio is broadly getting more diverse, or is it still like really not?
It's hard to tell. I think, I honestly don't know. I think, you know, for the most part, those who are diverse and in the hobby itself are kind of making themselves known. And it's because they've been getting encouragement. Like a lot of people, like I'm a member of OMIC and I talk to them too. And, you know, they have kind of been, you know, reaching out and trying to get people together. ARDC
might explain what OMIC is.
So OMIC is an organization of predominantly black. It's a predominantly black ham radio organization, historically black. What they started out as was back in the days of segregation, people used to, you know, on the air, used to not listen to them and not want to talk to them, especially when it came to finding a place where they're traveling and they use amateur radio to find a place to find lodging for the night. So they formed their own organization to cater to that need and, you know, basically help out their fellow black radio amateurs. And that, of course, you know, with the end of segregation and the Civil Rights Act and all this other progress we've made, they've kind of become like more of a social group, one, and two, they also have a scholarship fund. So that is their thing. And, you know, but I mean, to me, they're a very good place to find out about, you know, people who had a different story, right? Because some of them actually went back, they've been around in the 50s and such like that when they had this sort of thing happening.
Yeah, I did it's one. Interesting. Go ahead.
It's interesting. My exposure to amateur radio groups here in Southern California is, and I'm either involved or peripherally involved or just, you know, happen to visit with one group or another over time. Of all of the groups, the ARRL Aries sponsor group is the most diverse. Am I saying, is it very, very equal and even? No. But some of the other groups, the, you know, LA County Sheriff's Department, DCS group is not diverse at all. It's what you, you know, kind of expect to see based on that cover of the QST from January of this year. But in our Aries group, in both the Aries Northeast and Northwest group, is there is a lot of diversity. And, you know, it's a hobby and it's a volunteer organization and you can't mandate, you know, who comes and shows up. I'm, you know, I work in the entertainment industry and there's a lot around DEI. That's the new kind of the new hot topic, and making sure there is, you know, diversity and equity and inclusion, you know, across the board in our organization and in the industry that we support doing, you know, TV and movie. It is important to them and there is a lot of time spent on it, but looking at an organization where, you know, you show up to volunteer or, you know, or mentor or just hang out as a hobby, a little harder to control if you could even do that.
It's not.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I'm. Yeah, Gary, I think you probably want to say what I want to say. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that it's not a matter of, and what people will say was, we don't have any barriers. You can just come in. That doesn't solve the problem.
But I don't think that's really true because I think there are barriers. I think we create artificial barriers because people are not welcoming and friendly. And
yeah, they're not super big overt barriers that you can't overcome, but even a little resistance is too much.
So, yeah, so exactly. There are barriers, there are soft barriers, there are hard barriers. And if I might go off script a little bit, I've been doing stuff with the ARRL Foundation as well too. And we had this big club grant program funded by ARDC. And ARDC, by the way, is very big on DEI. They, one of the things I asked to be added to the scoring criteria was, you know, a diversity statement, basically, how are you going to encourage people, you know, different demographics in your project. A shocking number of grants applications basically said, we welcome everybody and anybody. That's not what the question was asking. The question, you know, I've seen some really, really good ones that said we work with Girl Scout troops. I saw one that said we work with, you know, minority communities, with inner cities, you know, and that's kind of what it is. And, you know, it's not about quotas or anything like that, but it's recognizing that there is a need and maybe, you know, extending a hand, right? Basically saying, hey, you know what, we have this thing, come and join us. It's kind of like in the schoolyard. You see the kid who's out there alone on the playground, you know, thinking of how they're not welcome and with the cool kids. And then it takes one kid to say, hey, I notice you're new here. Do you want to come play with us? That's all it is.
Yeah. And radio clubs are notoriously difficult to get warm fuzzies from for new people. Not all of them, mm-hmm. but you hear it all the time. ARDC is the group that has formed out of a digital group, but is no longer digitally focused primarily. They got money from selling a great big block of domains that ham radio had reserved for them.
IP addresses.
Yeah. In the early days of the internet, when they were free for the taking practically, and now they are rare and turned out to be worth a lot of money. They have sold some of them and gained millions and millions of dollars. And now as a group, they are distributing those as grants. So that's what the ARDC is from. So, lots of acronyms. We did a show on them a couple months ago. Go watch and find out all about ARDC. All right. So that was sort of the first thing that I was thinking of as I was thinking of the things that you've been involved in. The other two are a book that you have written that you have had trouble from the ARRL management and board, and then things going on in the board of directors in general. And now I think it is time to go back into a little bit of history and find out where we are. When I left off, as I kind of faded out of ham radio for a few years, code of conduct and the idea that the directors in the ARRL should line up behind ARRL policies in lockstep, the policy or not, after it was passed out by the board. As a director, you should not criticize it. You should not say anything about it. You should just support it. And that sounded horrible to me. And that sat around for... Yeah, it's YouTube that's giving me trouble. I'm going to drop Facebook off the deal.
Yeah, it's buffering now.
Yeah, YouTube is buffering just now.
Okay, well, I'm taking a moment anyway. I should have plenty of bandwidth because it's a fiber connection here, but we'll see. Anyway, as I was kind of fading out of things on Ham Radio late, they censured Dick Norton and 6AA, the Pacific. What's his official title? Now, things were not good up in Newington. And we did a couple of shows on him back then, and then kind of tossed everything over to David. So can we pick up from around there, or do we have to go back farther to?
No, I think we could pick up from around there. The good was we managed to elect four directors to replace four who were, pretty much in lockstep with the censure and other stuff. I defeated one of them, Michael Senko, into YBB. And it was quite an adventure in the ARRL board, being inside the boardroom. And I can tell you that some things were pretty much what I expected, some are not. But anyway, I'll tell you, the censure got reversed within like a year. The code of conduct was rescinded. The first meeting we also passed some transparency rules, which, by the way, benefited me with this whole book issue. And we also, you know, did a few other things to kind of basically bring back the balance of power. And now that went well. And then, you know, I think within like the next election cycle, though, two of those directors lost their elections. So Fred Hoppengarten lost his election. Who else? But W2RU, he lost his election. And of course, one of the directors who were defeated came back. So, you know, kind of like the balance of power started to tip back. On top of that, Jim Teamstra, K6JAT, the former Pacific Division director, he unexpectedly passed away. You know, they were, and that kind of shifted the balance of power in an unknown direction, because his replacement, of course, was the vice director, Kristen K6WX. And to be honest, I wasn't really sure, you know, what her views on things were, re-transparency and such like that. I did find out quite recently, but, you know,
what did you find out?
You know, she kind of voted with the House.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's what I'll say. Basically, I didn't really think that, you know, she'd be, I mean, everybody's independent, right? Everybody has their own independent thought, but no, she basically voted with the House with, you know, to act against me and even act against other directors who kind of stood in solidarity with me. And that was the most shocking thing.
Do we need to divert over to the book thing and then get back to what else is going on the board? Would that help fill things out a little bit?
Yeah. So those who don't know about the book thing, I was contracted by a company to write a book.
Is that the one in the background there, the antenna book?
No, that's Rotemel's antenna book. Okay. That's a German, that's a wonderful antenna book that was recently translated into English. But no, I wrote a technician study guide. So I had actually started writing the book, and then, you know, close to completion, I reached out to E&E. Because to be quite honest, I wasn't even sure the project was going forward. If you look in the news, the company was, they had some troubling signs, and I figured, you know, I didn't even know if the project was going to go through completion. But I did reach out to E&E, and told them that I was in the process of writing a book.
E&E is the ARRL Ethics and Elections Committee.
Ethics and Elections Committee. I'm sorry, I have to explain acronyms for people.
I'll help.
Ethics and Elections Committee, which basically they're kind of like the I want to say the judicial system of the ARRL board, right? Although they're not really, but they're basically the committee that creates findings on matters of ethics and conflict of interest. And so I sent it to Art Zygielbaum, K0AIZ, who was the chair of E&E. He actually, he sent back a note. I volunteered to recuse myself from book discussions. And then he came back and said, no, we don't see any conflict of interest.
Because ARRL publishes study guides, the license manual or whatever they're calling it these days. Is it back to being the license manual?
Yeah, so that was in June. And then in November, as the book was published in ebook, I got an email from Art saying, you know, now that your book's published, we need to talk about, why don't we do a Zoom call? So I did a Zoom call with him. You know, a number of issues were raised. I mean, the first one problem he had was he says, so why does the author page list me as the author and not, you know, not the publisher? I say, well, because I'm the author. You know, I wrote the book.
Is that a fundamental misunderstanding of publishing?
Yeah. Well, you know, ARRL, when they publish books, they don't list like Ward Silver or whoever else writes a book as the author, the licensed books. I think Ward writes some of the licensed books. I'm not sure. But they list the ARRL. But the thing is, you know, I wrote this book. I don't own the rights to it anymore. It was sold completely to them. But, you know, so
leaving, that was the leaving first. You phenomenally wealthy, I'm pretty sure.
Yes, I'm so wealthy. Yeah.
It doesn't work that way.
I'm going to buy a nicer Airstream than Jim. Jim, after seeing yours at Quartz Fest, I'm so jealous.
Well, you can get a baby one you can tow behind your Tesla truck.
True.
Okay.
Here we go. Let's go back.
Yeah. So
I can tell you from publishing that unless you strike the right deal, you don't own the book unless you write it into the contract. And luckily, in all of mine, I made sure all the copyright reverted to me when they went out of print. So I own them all.
Yeah, I don't get royalties or anything. They just pay me one time. So, but I do get some concessions. Like, I could buy copies of the book to give away on YouTube. You know, I can't sell it in their trade channel, their regular retail channels. So anyway, the other question they asked was, they said, did you consult any of ARRL's materials to write this book? I'm like, no, I didn't. And I wouldn't dare plagiarize because the publishing company warned me that if I plagiarized anything, they would not only drop the book, but they would probably sue me. Mm-hmm. Right. So I didn't want to plagiarize anything from anybody. Besides, I don't, you know, my reputation's online. So that was the other thing they asked. And then the other thing is he asked to see a copy of the contract. So I provided to him on condition that he keep it within the board because it's sensitive, you know, matter to me. Then apparently he came back and said, well, you know, you disclosed this when you were almost done writing the book. And that was the what their whole argument hinged on. Okay. That, you know, that how I didn't like disclose this to them as soon as I knew this project was happening.
You should have asked her for permission rather than later forgiveness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the thing is, both, you know, the contract, if you read it, it had a mutual exit clause. Like, they could have dropped me, I could have dropped them at any time. And if they said no, I was just going to leave. But it was kind of stupid on my part, admittedly. Okay. At the same time, it's an issue without impact. It's like they came, you know. They came and they said it was okay. Would they have said it was not okay if they knew the timing? That seems kind of like, you know, a chicken and egg scenario, right? But anyway, so they brought up this conflict of interest. They went into, we had a meeting. They brought up an initial, after the Zoom calls, I got, well, you know, I am not having any of this, really. So, they asked for another Zoom call. I said, no, I want your questions in writing, right? Because things could disappear in a Zoom call. You know, it could be a he said, she said situation. And I wanted it in writing. So eventually they sent me some questions in writing about they asked me various questions in writing. And then after that, I said, so who's making this complaint? And then Art came back and said, there's no complaint, right? They just have questions. I said, well, you know, if there is no complaint, there can be no investigation. So eventually he confessed that it was the CEO who made this inquiry and complaint.
So there was a complaint.
There was a complaint. And I was very annoyed that, he took so long to basically say it was CEO that did it, as if he was trying to hide that fact. And then anyway, long story short, they presented a report that said that I must be disqualified. They found a conflict of interest, and they kind of like just really, really laid it on thick and said, yeah, you know, the how I breached fiduciary duty, and then we can't have any separate mailing lists, recusals not enough, and, you know, so you must be disqualified from the board. That motion went in the meeting, and then we had a meeting with lawyers and all this kind of stuff. So by the way, remember I talked about reforms? One of the reforms that we passed was the rules for ethics and elections, where I, the accused, where anybody accused in a matter of E&E can make all of the facts relevant to the matter public, right? So what happened was, you know, we had a meeting and two of my colleagues, John Robert Stratton and 5AUS from West Gulf, and Bob Familio, then vice director of Atlantic, which is basically like Pennsylvania, Maryland, et cetera. They went to my defense, you know, and they're lawyers, of course, but they weren't acting as my lawyers, but they have been through some of this politics on the board. And they basically, you know, we went for 6 hours with two lawyers in the room. Basically at the end of it, you know, it was asked if anybody's supporting this motion. I think two people reluctantly said yes, and the motion was withdrawn to come back to see if we could go back, adjourn and go for another day to see if we could resolve this matter. Okay.
Okay, so the motion was to put the debate on standby and come back, and you lost that motion.
No, the motion was to disqualify me.
Oh, okay.
And then that one was pulled. Disqualify as in remove me from all my committee assignments and basically have me sit in the hallway at the board meetings.
Okay. So they can't remove you from the board, but they can take away all the things that you would do.
Right. They could put me in a rubber room, basically.
Okay. So that lost.
Right. That lost. And then what happened was the E&E came and had another, you know, Zoom call with me. And basically, initially what they proposed was not allowing me to serve on the executive committee, not allowing me to serve on administration and finance, right? Not allowing me to talk about this issue. So in other words, waive my rights to be transparent, right? To hide this whole matter. And then there was one other condition, I think they said that, no, well, anyway, that was a major part of it. And I said, no, I said, I'm not doing this. I'm not waiving my rights. The people elected me, my members elected me to serve them. And if you're going to want to cut down any of that, you're going to have to go to them. Okay. And he said, okay. And then they came back with this recusal motion. Okay, but in the recusal motion was, you know, was basically them passive aggressive is what I would call it. It recused me, but then it also accused me of being non-cooperative, which is bullpucky. You know, I'm trying to use nice language on your channel.
we have been known to utter the occasional obscenity. We don't make a practice of it, but we don't avoid it entirely. So for example, you can say it was bullshit.
Okay. Right. So they did that. And then they also said how I breached fiduciary duty. But these, you know, and I was engaged in a conflict of interest. And guess what? The report cited things like a social media post, say I'm going to write more books. I didn't even put a time frame. Let's say I retire from the board and I decide that I'm going to write books about ham radio, or I write books about something else. I do work in so many other things, drones, solar power and renewable energy, electrical engineering, non-ham radio related, IT, Linux, you know, finance, right? And all sorts of stuff. Even my job would probably have me problems with me writing a book about finance, but, so, you know, I didn't even specify, and they took this and they ran with it. And in the meeting, basically, they tried to imply that how I copied their book, because I was on this revenue subcommittee that Fred Kemmer is the chair of every committee. Okay, let's get that out the way. That we were talking about
what's strategy. Fred's position?
He's director of New England.
He's chairman of...
Yeah, he gets put as the chair of every committee.
Really?
Yeah.
What's wrong with that picture?
Oh, it's, yeah. Right. But it's like they accuse me of stealing ARRL book strategy, because if you look on the license manual, they have these small concentric circles. And on the book artwork, which I didn't even design, they have like big concentric circles. And then the book says everything you need to go know to get your ham license. And the ARRL book kind of says that too. But you want to know something? I've known to been saying in my videos, especially the RF safety video, I said, everything you need to know about the FCC rules regarding RF safety and exposure. So that's a line I've used for a long time.
It's a pretty generic statement.
It's generic.
I think
exactly.
I think we could go find prior art all over the place for something like
that. Well, who hasn't? Everything you need to know about antennas for the new ham. Everything you need to know about passing your general. Everything you
Right.
need to know about passing your extra.
Bonding and grounding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What I'm getting the impression is that they were nitpicking to try to find stuff on you.
Yeah,
Yeah.
so this is a fishing expedition, right?
They ever
To
did
use
they
a
ever whip out the agreement or contract that you signed to become a director, and does it have any of that in there?
they use a conflict of interest statement. They put that in a report too. And
But that was
yeah.
all that was there.
Yeah.
There weren't any specific prohibitions on.
No, the only specific provision they had is equipment, and I'm not going to be ICOM. Right.
Prohibition from making
From
from doing.
manufacturing ham
Okay,
equipment.
so you can't make any ham equipment while you're still a
Right.
director, which is pretty much
Yeah.
true of, I think, of any of the directors.
Right.
You can't get into the ham
Yeah.
radio business. So what was the bottom line? What did they end up finally charging or voting to do about you?
Oh, so by the way, the one thing in the Zoom call I didn't cover, they wanted authorization to sue me for this whole thing. They want to give the CEO authorization to initiate legal action against me. It's a scare tactic,
I'd be scared.
Well,
So where do you end? I'm sorry, go
were
ahead.
the damages that they were asserting to such that they would sue you?
I think we spent more money, and I don't have these numbers because somebody else asked for them and they haven't gotten an answer. You might have heard about it at Quartz Fest. And
Oh, on their witch hunt.
Yeah,
Is
and I'm
that
pretty
what Dick
sure.
was looking for? He was saying he had asked for some figures, which he normally gets immediately, and they, as of Quartz Fest, a week later, had still had not.
No comment. But
He didn't say what they were either.
Right. But, so the long story short is, I'm pretty sure that any amount of money diverted away by me in this little book to them, basically, I think they already blew it on lawyers.
Oh,
Yeah.
they would have tried to recover that. Any book revenue, but certainly you're doing something to promote the hobby, and through your charm encourage people to join the ARRL. So that's recurring membership in support of things to keep you pushed down. So I went through. I never went through a contentious issue writing books when I was working in the PC industry, but all my employers knew what I was doing, and for the most part realized, hey, this is good for us because our technical marketing engineer is well known, and nobody expected any the company expected any PR out of it, except that, hey, we have an expert here who can speak highly of our products. So conflict of interest can either exist if it's direct, which in your case and mine weren't, and can work to their advantage. Look at the quality of people we have working for us and what they're doing to promote our entity. So it sounds a little crazy.
Yeah, and this is what it is. And Bruce Perens kind of made a point that he thinks that the real conflict of interest is the ARRL having a book publishing business. But and that should be managed separately, and away from the like the advocacy arm of the league.
So how much is this, is this challenging the pro and the anti-transparency folks? I mean, ARRL is, I guess it might help to understand the nature of what the corporation is and what the membership and the public can expect of transparency. But at least in the 501c3 I'm responsible for now, transparency is everything. We make everything, you know, unless we have to go into executive session for something very, very exceptional, which has never really happened. Our members get to know everything we're doing, who we're doing it with, and why. So how, well, is, how does this cover the ARRL in trying to force non-transparency?
I, you know, yeah, so exactly. The ARRL, I mean, there is a definite, so Dick Norton always talks about the pro-transparency faction and the pro-secrecy faction. I view it a little differently. And Dick Norton has used this analogy many times. You have the pro-corporation side, meaning people who view the ARRL as a corporation. And then you have the pro-radio club side, people who view ARRL as a radio club. I kind of sit in the middle. I view ARRL as a membership organization for radio amateurs and an advocacy organization, a nonprofit. I don't view ARRL as a corporation, like, let's say, a, you know, a General Motors or something like that, you know?
So what is ARRL's status as a corporation? It's not a 501c3, is it?
Yeah, it's a it C3.
Mm-hmm. Well, the foundation is...
The foundation is.
The foundation is a 501c3.
No, I think the ARRL League itself is a C3.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's kind of an important distinction, because if you were a private corporation like GM, well, even the shareholders get board meeting minutes or some more information as a GM stockholder than we seem to be, that seems to be available here. So
the ARRL is definitely a C3 because all your donations are tax deductible. And I deduct my donations.
Yeah. Doesn't do me any good, but okay.
Well, I mean, we're encouraged to donate every year.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no, I understand the donation. Whether it's a write-off or not, is valuable as a write-off is questionable.
But. Yeah. Took a quick look here at something called Charity Navigator. They show the foundation is, but they also show that the league itself is 501c3. So we're there.
So that begs even more the transparency. You know, if you're a foundation for education and promotion of something that's non-commercial, what could you possibly be doing in the back room that, you know, would not be public?
Well, here's the other thing, and somebody raised in a chat, you know, universities encourage their professors to write books. ARRL is an educational institution. What's the difference? ARRL is not really an educational institution, but it's an educational, I guess, charity. There are other directors who write books, and I'm not attacking them in any way. There is one who wrote a book that was published by CQ Magazine. I'm not attacking him anyway. He should have that freedom to do that. Mm-hmm. And I respect him very much. I do think that, you know, the league decided to treat me differently for whatever reason. I don't think it has anything to do with race or gender or anything like that. So let's just get that out there. I do think it has to do with the mindset of me raising concerns about things and me going against the grain for some things.
Is that other person you're talking about publishing is part of the non-transparency faction?
I honestly can't read him. I think he's kind of like in the middle, and, you know, he kind of like gets sold on good ideas and bad ideas, and, you know, people will convince people to vote one way or the other.
I skipped a beat here as you were mentioning something because I wanted to bring this up, because I remembered the four pillars. The ARRL is education. Right. Yes. On their website. It is education.
They're not a school, is probably what I meant. But they're definitely an educational charity or an educational, you know, educational organization.
Yeah.
All right, Jim, you win. Okay.
And it sounds like they wouldn't have me on the board any more than they want you on the board now. So takes two. We'd be real trouble in that room together.
Oh, baby. Oh, yeah. Well, you know, there's like my there's been a lot of things going on I've seen, and then, you know, clashes I've had with. I know the ironic thing is that Mincer wouldn't be there if it wasn't for me, most likely, because I'm the one who basically told him everything he needed to know to become CEO.
Okay, right? So we're moving into new territory here.
Yeah.
Have we wrapped up everything between you and the book and in the league? Okay.
Yes.
So you have a beef with the CEO now. He's been CEO for what, 2 years?
I don't have a beef with him, really. I think he decided to pick a fight with me.
He's got a beef with you.
Right.
And do you understand it? Do you know what it is? Do you know what the basis is?
I have a couple of theories.
Are you willing to put them on television?
I can tell you things that I've told people already publicly.
All right.
One of them is that people who know me know that I am a subject matter expert on several IT things. Some I don't really disclose a lot, but it has to do with keeping organizations secure. We have had issues with the ARRL.net forwarding ever since they upgraded the backend system to Personify. And I was getting member complaints, and I was getting people, even it was so embarrassing that my own section manager, I had to email him things from ARRL for clubs, and mail was bouncing to him. The affiliated club coordinator. I raised this to the CEO, and I got the excuse that, yeah, you know, spam filters are blocking us, and, you know, there's nothing we could do about that. We need to not spend so much money and time on ARRL.net. It was brought up in an executive committee meeting, even though I was never part of the executive committee. We are allowed, every director is allowed to attend every meeting. So
we probably should explain ARRL.net just a little bit. Yeah. All I know of it is the email forwarding service that's available to members. Is there more beyond that?
So the email forwarding service, yes. So basically you can get an email address at ARRL.net. And you can, how you set that up is you go in your member profile and you turn it on. So it'll forward to your registered email address within ARRL.
Okay. And so that was what was breaking.
Yeah, a lot of hams use that. You know, it's probably not the most talked about member benefit, but a lot of hams use it because it's easy to remember your call sign at ARRL.net, and you put that in QRZ. You don't have to put your real email address.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, you know, it's useful. I use it for a while.
Mm-hmm.
We're having problems, and the problems really reached fever pitch when we upgraded Personify, when we upgraded to Personify, switch over to Personify.
So it stopped forwarding reliably?
Yeah. And, you know, having expertise in what I have expertise in, I knew there was some issue where it had a backend directory miscommunication. So basically, it was not pulling in the member records into the forwarding system to activate it. I raised that and I said, well, that's a real reason. It's not spam filters. The other thing I observed, because you can observe on the outside, is we didn't follow a lot of best practices. We didn't have authentication for email, something called DMARC, right? Basically, what it does is authenticates email servers to reduce the likelihood that you'll end up on an email blacklist.
Right.
We didn't have proper spam filter, records and such like that. So we didn't have a lot of these best practices. I raised that to the CEO, and he basically just, you know, he took offense to that. So I raised a motion at the July meeting. Well, I raised a motion at July meeting to actually enhance ARRL.net and basically fix all the problems and keep it as a member service, because there was a proposal to basically start charging for it. And, you know, move it to like Gmail or something like that. So I said, no, we want to keep this as a member benefit. So I raised that motion. He went full ballistic on that. He, really, really pushed on that. And then eventually it was just me and John Robert Stratton who supported the motion, and that motion got pulled. Since that time, things have been extremely sour between me and him. He hasn't been even looking me in the eye. He went to my one of my ham fests, and then after that, I think he got, we got turned off. I also raised the issue of the diversity in QST, and that's when I got lashed out at. And then, then things just went rapidly downhill.
Yeah. So the diversity thing, that was in the mix of things where he was already upset with you for things.
Right. Exactly.
And that just another touchstone.
Yeah. So, it's like, I really, we're all adults. I think that whole thing was childish, to come and basically, rather than speak to me and try to work something out, to basically just lash out at me. I mean, you guys read the editorials where you see the words like 3%ers and, other stuff.
Yeah, sadly, I have not read a QST editorial in a while. I don't dig into the magazine much like I really should. So what is he saying?
Well, basically, at least in two or three of them, there's been talk of criticism on social media. So, lashing out against criticism on social media.
What is the 3%er thing?
The 3%ers are basically a nickname for the group of people who basically just bash the league.
Okay, so he's upset that the league has got perpetual people who complain about it.
Right.
On social media forums. Yeah. Well, we've got some of them in our chat room right now.
3% is actually a pretty low dissatisfaction number.
Yeah, I'd be happy
with that. Comparison to some things.
Right. So,
Dick had mentioned something. People talk about the ARRL being a big business, and it's not really until Dick mentioned the number that there's $34 million in managed finance behind the organization.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's probably a little more.
$34 million, and what's the run rate on that? Where's that going? It's just sitting there.
No.
It's not buying Yagis and more acreage for the ARRL's exclusive remote DX station. So where's that money? What's that money there for?
Well, yeah. I mean, unfortunately, we've had to, draw from it because I think this is well known that the league isn't really doing a lot. The annual report will tell you we're running at a loss. So,
well, yeah, I guess that's the key. Dues are not covering expenses, right. So we're pulling from surplus.
Dues and donations.
Yeah.
And advertising, QST, other income sources.
And selling
sources.
Books.
Yeah.
but remember, it's a not for profit. So,
it's also a not for loss.
Well, okay, yes, but $34 million is, it's not a huge amount of money depending on if you're a multinational, corporation, but it's also not a small amount of money. And for a membership organization that's a 501c3, those dues should go back into supporting us, the members. And yes, keep the organization afloat.
Is there a complaint that the league is not doing enough for members, or things that you want to see?
Did you listen to Dick talk? There were a lot of comments from the audience from they should, ARRL should sponsor a winter field day to, more publishing or better publishing or more, openness. And I mean, you see it in other places too. Facebook, there was the whole Lincoln, I don't know, it was Elmer's or one of the other amateur radio groups last week about the DEI and, you know, are women included or not included, and the whole, that was a, I don't want to say it, but it was a shit show. And it represents badly a lot of the face of amateur radio.
I will, somebody in the chat says ARRL, is there a full-time IT person in Newington? Yes. Thankfully, they've hired our IT director, who oddly enough, in the administration and finance meeting, confirmed a lot of things I have been complaining about. And he has fixed some of them. So rather than having denial from CEO, there is confirmation that those issues exist. The other thing that peeved me was that in what world in 2022 do you take down a website for a week to upgrade software?
None. We'd all get shot. We'd all have been fired.
Well, yeah. So, Jim, well, all the people responsible for rolling out technology would have been fired.
When I ran FoxNews.com and, you know, Fox Business and all these sites, even the Fox Nation, which is set up for people to argue with each other and bash each other over the head, if that goes down for 1 second, we would have screams from the third floor. You know, even Roger Ailes, when he was alive, would have probably come up and started to breathe fire.
So why did that happen?
You know what? I still cannot get a straight answer as to why we took it down for a week. And the thing is, the way you do it is you build your system in parallel, you test, and then once it's good, you switch over in the middle of the night.
It would have cost money to virtualize it, to have two shadow environments, one under dev and one in production, and, you know, just switch the Ethernet cables and go, oops, that didn't work, switch them back. Okay, let's go fix it again. That's really tough. That's really a complicated situation.
But you know, Jim, that's what we have $34 million for.
I remember some of what the $34 million should be going to support and fix.
Yeah, I remember complaints about logging on, and I had trouble logging on for a while. Now, it seems to have been straightened out. I can get on there the way I expect now, but yeah, it took a long time.
So anyway, so those were some of the issues why we had, you know, beef.
Yeah, well, that all goes to the 3% or, you know, all that money goes to lawyers, all the snarky things people say. I mean, we all have our issues with some of the things, and you're bringing, how much trouble are you in for bringing some of these to light or confirming some of what we thought we understood about what's going on? And this, how does the membership get heard? It's disappointing when you find that the successor in your region, your division, is no better than the one prior, who is apparently one of the non-transparency people. And I'm thinking, well, what is there to hide? Why leave this cloak of mystery and suspicion out there if there really is none? What motivates people to say, well, I'm a board member of this thing and we prefer not to talk about it? That's immediately should be a 97% or what are you hiding? That's not a 3% issue. That's a 97% issue.
Yeah. So it's pro corporate versus pro radio club. But, you know, there is middle ground, membership association, nonprofit. But yeah, I mean, you know, it is the mindset that, for lack of a better comparison, that we have to be like Apple, who keeps everything secret until they have a big launch event.
We don't do half as much for things as Apple does. As much as I'm not really an Apple fan, we don't do nearly anything compared to what Apple or Elon or anybody might possibly bring to the world.
And this is, you know, this is something else that I'm just going back to Gary's, or was it Gary or you or David who asked, the members asked me, what do they get for their membership dues?
They get a magazine.
They get several.
I think that's what a lot of people think. And I'm making fun. And I'm sorry, Rhea.
No. You have that.
You know, Gary knows, Jim knows. That's what a lot of people think. Well, yeah. I'm just getting a magazine. And maybe I'm helping to support some greater good, but most people think.
It's a subscription. Magazine is a subscription.
Yeah. You know what? I think the major part of it is the magazine. There are a lot of value add services like the lab, TIS, and all sorts of stuff. But the advocacy, I'm glad we have two bills being filed now. I kind of understand why they had to wait a while, but in the members' eyes, it wasn't looking good. We have the FCC has been ignoring us. And, you know, a lot of members are thinking, well, what are they paying $49 for? And I was told that is going to go up. I mean, you know.
I pay for the right to, for the privilege of bitching, which I don't really do. Right. But one of my concerns is, as far as, and I think technical information services might find an opportunity to be of more benefit, at one of the Pacific Division meetings a couple of years ago when Jim was still with us, there were a couple of people who submitted technical articles with schematics and that were published. And a month after published, they were getting all this nasty email and phone calls going, I built your circuit and it doesn't work. You know, what the heck's wrong with this thing? And I said, well, okay, let's, you know, they walk through things and finally opened up QSD and looked at the schematic and found out that the production department of QSD could not take whatever format drawing he provided and convert it and print it as is. They redrew the schematic in error. So 50 or 60 people were building this kit with the wrong parts placement. And I look at a number of things because in my world, peer review is, you know, is huge. There's no peer review, you know, every gimmick antenna in the world, whether or not it makes any sense is thrown out there. Oh, it's got great gain. Well, there was an antenna article or something just this last month about, it claimed something about more gain and the word gain never appeared in the article. I thought somebody teach these people how to write. You know, or throw it to me and I'll ghost write it for you.
Yeah. To be fair, you know, I don't really, I think the staff do a often thankless job. I think there is a lot of pressure being placed and, you know, there is basically, I mean, yeah, you're right. You know, sometimes there needs to be a little more attention to detail. Maybe the environment needs to be adjusted for that to happen. Yeah. There is some failure somewhere. I've seen, you know, books with errors and such like that. And, you know, that's been a known thing for years. You know, a lot of the books.
Yeah, well, that's one of the important things we have to do on social media. And what I desperately try to do in the responses I give in my own Facebook group and others is, I'm calling my RF dude before I answer this question, or I'm going to go look it up because, okay, you know, I was taught by a bunch of Elmers that taught me wrong things. And, you know, when you start blowing up enough stuff and go, oh, you talk to real engineer, he says, well, that's why that's happening. That's something I, you know, that I personally can't let out of my wheelhouse is telling somebody how to intentionally or ignorantly telling them how to do something wrong. Right. And the national organization compared to RSGB or Deutsche Amateur Radio Club, we pale in comparison to the quality of technical work that comes out of them. And they have far fewer members and, you know, much more stringent barriers to entry, as it were, to qualify to be a ham. So.
And you'd think if a big part of the business was in the publishing of books and reference materials, they'd have their act together in that way, or at least have had enough experience of here's what you need to do and let's apply that level of you know, oversight to everything that gets done. It is surprising.
Yeah. I do definitely think that that's something needs to be improved.
Does the board get involved in that kind of oversight or insight into operations of the corporation?
So the board is not supposed to, and we do get a report from the CEO. That's his job.
I guess I don't understand. You're not supposed to. What part of the ARRL does the board run, and what part do they not?
So ARRL, the board is governance. We basically set policy. And, you know, we do, the committees do a lot of, like, you know, work into getting, like new programs. When I mean programs, like new, like one of the things I was working on with this revenue subcommittee was to get a new activity to get hams on 10 and 6 meters. So, you know, that sort of thing.
Okay. Yeah. So I can see difficulties with board of directors trying to micromanage things inside publishing QST and other activities, but you do have, I mean, the board runs the ARRL.
Right.
Well, so, CEO runs it, manages it day to day, but you guys are all responsible for literally everything.
So don't get me wrong. If we do see something, we say something. We don't say it to the staff, we say it to the CEO, and then it trickles down.
And that's not one of those transparency things. That's not where you get on my ARRL my ARRL voice on Facebook and start complaining about it, at least not until you see nothing happening.
Yeah. So we do, you know, and this goes back to what I was saying. I complain about the tech issues. It's not like I'm going to go to the IT director and yell at him. I'm going to go to the CEO and say, hey, this is wrong. Can you get somebody to fix it? And, you know, I would expect not to be ignored. I would expect not to be lashed out against. You know, I would expect to a response that, okay, let me see how I can help.
Yeah.
So we've
asked why we think that people are coming down on you, and you don't really have a good answer for that. What is now going on at the ARRL board? What is the schism? Go ahead. I'll leave it open-ended, and you can just fill in.
No. Go ahead.
The openness versus transparency versus secrecy. What other aspects of the board have a pretty significant and continuous one side versus the other?
So there are a few critical things. One of them is the composition of committees. And as you might not know, the board meetings are really just formalities. Nothing really happens at the board meetings other than we pass motions. The real work happens in the committees. And the committees are picked by the president, except the executive committee, which is elected by the board. And so the executive committee basically is the board between board meetings. Administration and finance handles the business side of the house, things like the financial health of the corporation, the running of the publishing business, so to speak, the other things. QST, and technology, IT. So, and of course, tax and other related issues that the CFO might need authorization from the board for. So that's essentially what those committees do. And programs and services decides rules for contests, DXCC, that kind of stuff. What's going on in the ARRL now is that the balance of power has shifted to where, as Dick put it, the pro-transparency side is very weak. And we're not able to, for example, none of us got elected to the executive committee. The administration and finance, I was taken off because I got a notice that I was no longer on the mailing list. I might ask to get back on because every director can have visibility to anything they want, by the way. Those committees are going to be basically have appointees who are friendly to what I call the pro-corporate agenda, right? And people use the word agenda as if it's something bad, but it basically it's supposed to be innocuous word. So, and once that is done, I mean, you know, we'll see where it goes. I mean, next year you're going to have officer elections. You're going to have a new president, because I'm pretty certain Rick Rogers has been around for a long time. He's probably going to be retiring. You're going to have jockeying for that position. You're going to elect the CEO again.
President is elected out of the board, by the board, but not out of board members.
Well, he could be a board member. He or she could be a board member, or could be anybody, to be honest.
Have most recent presidents come out of board positions, out of director?
So, yes. So, Rick Rodrick was the ARRL first vice president. So normally it goes where a director then, you know, ascends to first vice president. And one second here.
Yeah, and then they're no longer being elected by the membership, that they keep working their way up.
Right. So anybody can be anywhere on or off the board could be president. But usually the practice is that either a director or an officer, one of the vice presidents, becomes president by the board. So that's going to be jockeyed for. And I have a pretty good idea who's in the running.
Once again, not ready to tell on television.
Well, you know, I could tell you. I mean, the guy who's on every subcommittee wants the job, I think.
Who is that?
The guy who's the head of every committee. Okay. I'm pretty sure he wants a job.
Okay.
You know? Yeah. So, yeah, so that's what's coming up. What else is coming up? I mean, you know, the CEO, like I said, will need to be re-upped by the board, re-elected by the board next January. And... you know, depending on the composition of the board, he stays or he goes.
We've had, what, a couple CEOs since Dave Sumner?
Yeah, you had Dave Sumner. You had the CEO who retired for tax purposes. And then you had the one who rhymes with the beer. And then you had this one.
Okay. And Dave Sumner was there for decades, so it seemed like sort of a permanent position.
Well, Dave Sumner initially wasn't CEO. I think at one time he was general manager, then they changed him to executive vice president, and then they changed it to CEO.
Yeah, but I mean, he basically ran the business for
right, for
a long, long time.
Exactly.
And so having a succession of people seems odd, but isn't necessarily that odd. All right. So... what do we do about this? Members don't get into this sort of thing. Your director elections are beauty contests. Am I fair saying that?
No, the director. So what can you do? I mean, there are several seats up this year. I think people need to challenge them. You know, the Midwest division is up, and the director for that election is the one who was the head of the Ethics and Elections Committee. You know, if people didn't like what went on, maybe somebody should challenge him. And there are other divisions which are up, people should challenge them. But the thing is, you know, people like talk to either, I've been trying to recruit for, like, not so much for elections, but I had to recruit a replacement for my vice director. I ended up, you know, I asked about 5 people and they couldn't meet the membership requirements. You have to be a member for 4 years at least. A lot of people just let their membership lapse. I don't know. I honestly, I'm at the point where I don't know what the magic bullet is. I think we could have people who, you know, run for, and we have another great revolution, another great sweep of 2018 that we had. And, you know, we ride that high for a few years and then come crashing back down, or do we, you know, I don't know what we do. And I will be honest, I don't know what my future is on the ARRL board.
Is your constituency strong within your division?
Well, they love me. Okay. They really, really,
So they would keep returning you, but your effectiveness at the board is going to be limited.
Yeah. And, I've been talking with other people about other things and, I really have to decide if this is even worth it.
Sounds like it's no fun.
You know what? I've been presented with other things and people have told me, they said, you could come with us and, you could either sell sugar water at the ARRL, you could come with us and change the world.
Apple reference to Steve Jobs and what's his
name?
I've
had that, I've been told that professionally as well in one company. And,
Okay. So are you enjoying your career as a YouTuber and podcaster? Do you call yourself a podcaster or just a YouTuber?
I need to start making more videos and I'm going to be making more videos. And you want to know something? I'm a podcaster. I'm also a radio host because we air the show first on the radio.
On WRMI, is that the shortwave station out of Florida?
Ted Randall and company, yeah. Yeah, I used to broadcast.
How do you get along with Ted Randall?
Ted and I are good friends, and Holly and I are good friends. He loves ham radio. I love ham radio. Okay. And this is something, a lot of people disagree with me on various things, but because we're hams, Jim and I've been begging Jim to buy a Tesla for the longest time, and Jim says, no, I'll keep my pickup truck.
I wouldn't have made it to quartz fest with my Tesla in the Airstream.
Yeah, but the thing is, point being that I enjoy getting the word out. I do need to start back. I have a few ideas for YouTube videos that I'm working on right now, and I enjoy doing it for the for the notoriety. For one, it's a beauty contest. But I do enjoy, people tell me they learned something. So I really enjoy that they learned something. And the podcast/radio show, people tell me they learned something. So I learned something.
And you may be carrying, in terms of YouTube and this presentation of ham radio, you may be carrying the diversity thing on your shoulders. We got you and Natalie.
You
have a protege, Dixie.
Dixie DX. Her life is complicated. She needs to get back to making more videos now. She has a new boyfriend, so
she's young.
I know.
Yeah. And there's Katie over on I guess these guys at W5KUB is still on. They snapped up Katie, who has just been appointed to the ARDC. I saw on her
they're a fine organization
Facebook page.
Yeah.
Yes, but we will have on a future ham radio now, we will have a little bit of controversy about ARDC coming up. I've got someone in the wings who wants to talk about that.
I've been told that a lot of things about them. I try to keep an open mind, but I want to see what they have to say.
Yeah. It boils down to they've got a lot of money and money is a problem. Anytime you got a lot of money, you have problems. And it is who is making decisions and how they get to make decisions. And not even necessarily that the people making the decisions are making corrupt decisions in any way. It's just that the decision making may be a little more concentrated than it ought to be.
There are two people that have kind of told me, but I guess I'll have to see who it is. I could make a relatively good guess.
My source is another one of the rare females in ham radio. So
I know exactly who and what you're talking about. Yeah. Well, and I can tell you that there's more to meet the eye. Yeah,
I hope they're favorable to my effort because I just put in a draft grant application and I want to talk to them about it and refine it before I get it passed through. I hope.
Well, I've been talking with Phil and Bob McGuire and they have a lot of good ideas about, about that organization. And if your grant is good, I mean, they've been basically flooded with grant applications, but if your grant is good, I hope you get it.
Somebody wants me to put up your call sign on the
M2RJ.
There we go. They're saying, who's your guest? I came in late. Who is your guest?
You see, I'm not the most famous ham in the world.
None of us are that famous.
No.
We could all
not Gordon West or Marty Lane.
We could all do better. Or these days, Josh on Crash Course. Everybody knows who he is, I guess.
Yeah.
All right. What else have we got here? Where can we go? David, what's going on? David's talking to the chat room.
I'm still recovering. Yeah, there's the chat room going on. I'm still recovering from Quartz Fest. I came home with a little bit of a sniffles.
Yeah, I do want to tell you a little bit of thing about, you know, in 2019, you know, Jim Teamstra was appointed to for the election of president. Did you know?
No.
Was that in the minutes? I think he was. Yeah. And he was defeated by Rick Roderick. That election kind of shocked me because there was, again, you know, one person, and I will not name who this person is, who basically voted against Jim because he wanted to be president. And so it's kind of like, you know, and then there's another one who said how he heard some story about a D expedition and EME, and he kind of like say, wow, you know, Rick really loves ham radio. Yeah. It's really weird. Like I said, you know, the politics, if it's one thing I can't stand, it's the politics. I really wish we could not have politics.
But well, you know, and I think in it locally, between our hands-free law debacle here, that local ARRL did not engage, and David will know that we weren't too happy when Southwest Division engaged, came into our territory without telling us, but we got ourselves over that. But that darn near killed the progress Norm and I had. And what's disappointing from the perspective of it, having two different divisions in the same state, that we couldn't all come together and share the word and do, well, like what's happening with the HOA issue, is everybody's going off on, you know, whether or not we're going to have any influence over government or anything. And people don't understand how government works. And it took Norm and I, you know, several months to convince the audience how we were going to be have a tactical advantage in Sacramento with the appropriate representatives without going all, you know, ape crap and all over the map. And we'd hope that the ARRL would have helped carry that message of, here's how you succeed in legislation. This is how this process is going to work. And we did it ourselves, fortunately. And now there's a push to do some refarming or accommodation for different technologies and spectrum. And since I'm president of the Northern California Coordination Group, there's a lot of pressure on us to come up with some kind of solution without anybody, you know, stepping forward with, well, I suggest we do this and this is how we're going to adhere to it and all that. We're carrying the burden of all the technology in this. But to that, rather than just stay within the the repeater owners group, realizing that repeaters serve users, and there are far more thousands of users with different technology needs and wants than there are repeaters, I tried to enlist and get the word out through the ARRL representatives to say, hey, you know, in your clubs, maybe in your quarterly newsletter, call attention to this issue that we're trying to get some technical, you know, we're trying to get some survey information out of the user base so that somebody doesn't make a unilateral technology decision and then y'all come back and get pissed off at us because you didn't know about it. Well, how am I going to get a hold of 70,000 hams? What better way than through the ARRL club structure and bupkis? I got responses of from 130 ARRL clubs in Northern California, and whoever else I got the message out to, I got 54 responses. That's not enough to say we got valid user input.
So, you know, we face the same situation here with a wireless bill that kind of just, you know, we had a very, very good advocate who was my former vice director, Bill Hudzik, W2UDT. He went down to Trenton and he talked with legislators and he got us fully exempted from distracted driving laws. And Bill was that kind of person. Bill could, you know, could literally sweet talk these people to get us exemptions.
We could have done that had the financing behind all of this not been a MAP 21 federal program, which did not allow exemptions. So if you didn't care about MAP 21 money, then you could do those things. But most of the states like having federal money come back, especially California, like having federal money come back to the state. So there was no way they were going to write an exemption for us.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
What was the outcome of that? Do you have a restriction or did that die?
There was never a specific restriction. It was just loose wording that could have given, field discretion above and beyond, or, you know, extend the meaning of distracted driving. So we got a win at that point. We got the wording corrected. So it was not so ambiguous and broad, in addition to having a statement from high up on the CHP that said, we're not going to bother with this. We have more important things to do.
Yeah, the reality is the distracted driving law didn't specifically call out amateur radio. It specifically called out hands-free wireless devices, which is not what we think of as, you know, yeah, maybe an HT is a hands-free wireless device, but that wasn't what they were intended to have or do or talk about. But the reality is if you're distracted driving and you're causing a problem, you're distracted driving and causing.
Yeah, you can still get tagged for it. Yeah, you can still get tagged for the offense if you're, you know, blatantly
right,
not paying attention.
And won't have a leg to stand on.
Yeah. So New York actually has this kind of situation where they don't actually have a distracted driving law, but they don't have a law, an exemption for amateur radio. Rather, they have an opinion from DMV that basically you could use in court if you're
right.
You
know. Oh yeah, permission to hire a lawyer.
Yeah. Well, no, right. that's
well, no, a, that's it's a statement around CHP. Yeah, and that's what they did in California. Is the CHP wrote a.
But don't present that to the officer that's writing you the ticket. You take that to court with you take your day in court and deal with it with the judge, not the officer.
Right.
Okay. Yep. Other things Dick Norton said, we are, did I talk about the three motions? One of them was a code of conduct coming back.
We briefly talked about that very early, but we didn't get into any detail. What do they want to do?
They put a study motion basically to E&E to study bringing back the code of conduct,
Do they have is it fleshed out? Do they have any details yet?
No, they're going to work with council. I mean, and
what's the point?
Yeah. The question was presented, I swear to God, if somebody shoots somebody with a gun at, you can appeal at any demonetization you get. Okay. If somebody shoots somebody with a gun in the ARRL board, can that person be disqualified? They can't be if we don't have a code of conduct.
Yeah, I mean, and an organization like this with a board of directors, there needs to be some kind of code of ethics or conduct.
Yeah.
Because, otherwise, and it's not just outlandish things like Rhea just said, but sponsorships and alignments and agreements and, pushing a vendors over another vendors or what have you. There are all sorts of possibility for bad
things. My thing is, and this was the point raised by my other directors, a lot of this was already covered under Connecticut law. If you're codifying what's in Connecticut law, if you're, you know, if you're strength, well, if you're codifying that and not trying to get around Connecticut law, like, for example, trying to disqualify members that you can't disqualify, because under Connecticut law, you cannot disqualify a director of the non-stock corporation unless the members, recall, or the members vote them out at the next election. The most you could do is take them off the committees and put them to sit in the hallway, but, you can't realistically remove them from the board. But, so a lot of this, I don't mind like a sensible code of ethics that lines up with Connecticut law. Where I have a problem is where you make something that could be weaponized to throw out undesirables. And this is the problem we had with the last code of conduct where they censured Dick Norton.
It's reoccurring. It is what Dick talked about. It's transparency versus the censorship, the private factions. And it doesn't sound like it's changed, and some boards work. It's not what I want representing me, but lucky for me, I voted for the guy who's standing out and was censored for speaking his mind. They tried to censor him for speaking his mind, and I'll continue to vote for him because I do believe that he represents at least my interests and my philosophy on what should be done. It's sad that there aren't more folks like that, but it's look at other things in the rest of our country and politics and whatever. It's just the way it is. It's the way of the world.
Yeah. And the other one, the other motion that passed was, it's more or less harmless, but it's kind of, it's a study motion again to basically create an E&E guidebook. I don't have a problem with an E&E guidebook. The problem I have is that the people on the committee and originally were supposed to be the members of this last 2022 E&E committee who caused trouble with me and other directors. So, who basically decided to bring up these issues where there were none.
Yeah, the reality of having a code of conduct or a guide should be everybody should embrace that. It should be in the makeup of what is in that guide and what, the thoughts behind it or the rules behind it. That's where people have to start to look at and say, well, does it make sense that, that you have to do this or you can't do that or what have you? And that's what they should be looking at is what do they want to have in the list of things? And depending on the makeup of the group that comes up with it, if it's, a group of the censorists, it may not bode well for what goes in there, but until you see what they put in it, it's hard to tell.
I'm just a little concerned that that it's going to be the same. I would have preferred some independent outside people who really have no interest in this, rather than people who aren't E&E who just basically want to double down.
Yeah. I remember a little bit of the dust up over on my ARRL Voice that happened recently from some of the comments that I was making about broadcasting or live streaming the ARRL board meetings. And somebody was, I don't know who he was, but you were telling me he's a classic objectionist. Somebody was saying it's impossible to stream them. They're so difficult, it would be extremely expensive. That sounds all from the secrecy side of things. Don't stream the board meetings.
So the streaming of the board meetings is absolutely not a technology problem. Okay. It is a lack of willingness to do so, because if you're streaming the board meetings, then people get to see everything, and then people get to see motions that were put forth, argued upon, and then withdrawn. That's not...
Those don't make it into the minutes, right?
Right. And there was one of those this past meeting that was very contentious. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to tell you about it because it's basically, you know, was withdrawn. But, oh gosh, it was, you know, when I sat down with the CEOs whose name rhymes with nickel, back when he came on and he was trying to convince me to go in his direction, he told me, he said, you know, he doesn't want to have the directors on stage. And I'm like, well, they're kind of elected by the membership, you know? I mean, I would have liked to see like what they have in court proceedings, which is where instead of a live stream, you know, at least because they record the audio for transcription purposes, why not just throw that audio up on the website?
We're even hearing the audio from the Supreme Court these days.
Right. Well, yeah, yeah, exactly.
So, yeah. I mean, the picture helps, but hearing people talk and hearing what they say and all of the stuff. Now, you say that most of the business goes on in the committee meetings.
Right.
Results of those committee meetings come up to the board and get either decided on or, you know, back to committee for more work. So, yeah, we're not going to see all of the sausage being made, but we're going to see more of it than we do now.
Right, exactly.
So.
Yeah.
It's just obstructionist to say, no, we can't do it. No way to do it. Technologically impossible.
Yeah, you know, I mean, as a technology person, I don't buy that.
Yeah.
You know?
Wait, are they saying it's technologically not possible? No.
Too expensive.
There was one person who was saying that. I can't remember who it was.
Yeah. Everybody's got a microphone in front of them. So yeah. You've got all the audio, and I'm guessing that there's a system that's got some gating, so it turns the mics down that someone's not actively talking into, so you don't get all the noise. And so if you're going to do a production, you pick that audio feed. And now you've got a few cameras. You got a wide shot camera or two, and then you got one camera with one person that can swing it over to whoever's talking. And I'm assuming things in the board are not so chaotic that every 3 seconds the person talking changes. Not that hard to do.
Yeah, no, everything is in order pretty much. You know, you raise your hand and then you get called in order. I mean, you know, like I said, the cameras are really not necessary because, I mean, there's really nothing to see in there. I think the audio would have been the more, you know, easiest thing to do. The audio is already recorded for transcription purposes. Just throw that up on a website.
We're not going to get that, are we?
No, we're not. Yeah, oh, no. Well. Yeah, there are people who say things in there who would never want that to see the light of day, especially since they're elected. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. We got anything else, you guys?
No, I think we're starting to peel layers of the onion back. I bet there's more to talk about, but I think later on, yeah, as things develop.
We don't have any updates on this amateur radio emergency response act yet, right? It hasn't been.
There are things that are in the background in terms of we're trying to get support from various members of Congress. And yeah. I'm actually working on a few things here in the Garden State.
Do we have a clue when that might get reintroduced?
I'm working on it, actually. We have, like, you know, meetings with people to figure things out. And I'm kind of involved in some of those.
So should we worry about that? Because nobody on the board likes you anymore.
There are people who like me, and they're the right people. You have John Robert Stratton and Bob Familio and who else? There are a couple other people.
Are the folks from the other side of the board, are they supporting this act as well? Is this a bipartisan
thing
at this point?
You want to know something? I think that if it passes, people are going to ride the coattails. And, you know.
Bask in the glow.
They're going to bask in the glow, and their boasted their members said, your league did this and your director supported it.
But if it doesn't work, they have deniability. Oh, we didn't really push that really hard.
We thought it was a waste of our $30 million, $34 million.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I hope some of this traffic, some of the attention this is given might cause some of the electorate in other districts that at the unit to be a little more curious about their directors and things now, because you know sometimes you just vote for whoever's there you like most, and now you've got to go back and ask them, are you for or against transparency? And that's, you know, that may challenge a few candidates now.
Yeah, I think, you know, and I have to be careful because I don't want to basically get caught up in being accused of election interference. What I could tell people right. is that if you see something that you don't like, talk to your director. And if you're not satisfied, you have the power to vote.
And that's the great thing is, Rhea, it's our job to say, you should go out and talk to your directors and see what they think.
Right.
We're nobody's going to accuse us of election tampering.
Right? Well, yeah, but you want to know something? I think the bigger problem is finding people to run, because a lot of people say they don't want to be bothered. And I don't think this is going to encourage them anymore.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean, I'm in the Roanoke division, and but we've had, I don't think we've had any lack of people wanting to be directors, but it's still, and I, looking at the voting record of my director on issues like this, not happy.
Yeah. Anyway, I see my camera's breaking up. It's probably a sign.
It's the sign that it's time to go. All right. Thank you for coming along with us, Rhea. And, anytime you want to come back, come chat with us. You have added significant diversity to something that lacks on this program. Because much as I might complain, it's typically a bunch of white guys and mostly old white guys, unless Marty comes along.
You want to know something? Like I said, I have many friends who fall into that demographic. I have no problem. Like I said, the analogy of the kid on the playground is the perfect example. Hey, kid, come on over and play. You're welcome. You know, we want you to sit on the swings with us.
Yeah. But you know, from my point of view, just saying, I wish some of the folks, some more women, people of color, anywhere in diversity in ham radio would come approach us. We should reach out, but that's hard to do in a very small operation like this. I'm not even sure where to go to say, come help us. I mean, I did one entire episode with the guys from Omic, when I had a studio in a booth at, Huntsville, and they had another booth, and I came over and said, come talk to me. And we had a great time, but you know, I haven't done much since then.
Yeah.
So should.
Well, maybe we can have them again. Maybe I'll come on when they come on. Just let me know.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm good. I'm part of that group too. So yeah.
It's not like you're shy, Rhea. You know, we really had to twist your arm.
Yeah. Okay. Took a little bit. All right. I'll start pushing the official buttons here. Let's see. Working our way backwards. Rhea Jerram, N2RJ. Director, everybody's on the bottom side has got to tell you what I can promote you. I can promote you here over on the Zoom to the top.
You put there Jim on the bottom.
Yeah, put Jim on the bottom.
That's all right.
Hudson Division Director, also YouTuber, Rhea Shack Ham Radio on the YouTube and on WRMI. When does that show come on?
So the show is at 5 p.m. Central, which is 2300 UTC on WRMI 4980.
But every day or what day?
Fridays. Okay. And it's available wherever you get your favorite podcasts.
All right. And is it all ham radio or what's your...
So it's primarily ham radio, but I talk about other wireless communications technologies. And sometimes, like this week, I was talking about artificial intelligence. So.
Okay, cool. And down to the bottom left corner.
Hello.
That's you, Jim. Tell people who you are and why they should go pay attention to you.
Why should you pay attention to me? Well, I've been a ham since I was born a ham. So, you know, if you can still make it this far, stay licensed, stay on the air from all the bad advice I got as a kid and learn how to get good advice. I guess it's that's worth something, and especially when you get to hang out with good folks like you guys. Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC, author Elmer, and once in a while an evil, idiot savant genius. We'll see.
Says evil genius here, and apparently a Wisconsin Badgers fan.
No, I'm still on.
Badgers, right?
Badgers.
Yeah. All right, David.
Hi, and I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Thanks for coming, Rhea. And
who's doing the photo bombing there, Rhea?
There's more to follow. Howdy.
Hi, sorry.
I want you to have a call sign next time we do the show, okay?
Okay, when is the next time?
Next time. It's going to be 2 weeks from now. You got to work hard.
Yeah, make this quick. Okay, David, finish up.
Anyways, yeah, thanks so much for coming, Rhea. And and fighting the good fight and being there to represent us, I appreciate it and salute you.
And you know what? I will try to make time to meet up in California.
We'll be here.
Yeah. We'll have to get another Airstream, David.
There you go.
This is going to be a co-ed Airstream.
I am the East Coast host, Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, King of Ham. And now it is the famous end of the show, three-word sign-off. Rhea, have you ever made it to the end of a ham radio now show?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's been on the show before, Gary.
You've been on a few times. All the way to the end. So you know how this works.
As any good guest would stay all the way to the end.
All the way to the end. And so I'll line it up for you. It's going to be David, Jim, and Rhea. Three words. David?
This was Ham Radio Now. Episode number, what was the episode?
Oh, yeah, I guess I could put that up here.
462.
462.
Wrong button. Over. Wrong button, sir.
And.
Over.
And.
Out.
Okay, now I'll push the correct button.
Thanks, Rhea.
I almost know what I'm doing on this show.
Thanks, Gary.
Thank you, guys. Good night, everybody.
Happy almost Monday to our East Coast friend.
Don't remind me.
I know. And we're getting back there, too.
Getting darn close to Monday.
Yep.
We didn't even cover Quartz Fest.
That's next week.
Oh. Okay.
You got lots of videos and stuff, right?
I condensed the 6 mile, the 6 hour off-road ride at 2,000 speed. It's 11 minutes long.
Yeah, that was fascinating. It looked like a bunch of little electric cars running around.
You know, what's really funny is every once in a while it pauses for a little while. It like pauses for 6 or 8 seconds. I realized we were sitting there a long time waiting for people. But So other stuff to share too. Got a lot of good pictures. We'll talk about it next week.
Right here, over most of this same YouTube channel. Which the stream has been excellent for a long time now. So I don't think it was my problem. I blame YouTube.
I agree.
Okay. I'm going to push a button to put a rare little bit of video on the stream and say goodbye to you guys.
There's video coming. Yeah.
See ya. Here's the video.
Oh yeah.
What? That's,
that's dating a CRT with video on it.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Good night, guys.
Very ancient.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Bye.
7-3.
Everything's going to black.